Want to first of all thank you for signing in and registering and having an interest in an AnAqSim, analytic aquifer simulator, and that's our topic today. I'm going to introduce that software and show you some of its applications, talk about how it compares to other software, and so on. And of course, I'm Charlie Fitz. I'm the author of an AnAqSim. And have been at this analytic element modeling business since the mid 80s, and had an earlier software product called Toudan. Some of you may be familiar with that. And basically put that aside and rewrote and started over with an AnAqSim because there are quite a few different concepts, and we'll get into some of that in a minute. Here I'm gonna get to the next slide, which is an outline of where we're going today. We're going to go over how the analytic element method works, and we're going to compare that to how numerical methods work, which is a way a lot of you have done modeling, I'm sure. And we're going to compare an AnAqSim to other analytic element method programs and talk about the range of capabilities and applications that an AnAqSim can handle. And I'll show you a few checks versus analytic solutions and modflow, and I will demonstrate an AnAqSim with one model live that is a fairly simple one, and then a couple of kind of moderate complexity that we'll go over as well with slides. And I hope to wrap all of that up in about 40 minutes, 45 minutes, and then have time for Q&A at the end. You'll see a chat box down there to the left, and if at any point in the presentation you think of a question, go ahead and type it in right there, and I will get to it in a and try to answer it at that last segment. Okay, I am going to disappear from view and put up just a picture of me instead, so that that won't be as distracting for you. There you go. Okay, first the analytic element method. It is based on analytic solutions to general flow equations. And that uppermost equation that I'm pointing to right here is the general flow equation that is generally employed in an AnAqSim. And it is two-dimensional. You see it's a function of x and y and time t, and you can create three-dimensional models with an AnAqSim by stacking two-dimensional layers on top of each other and then solving for the vertical leakage in between those two layers. And you can handle storage term here. You can handle transient flow quite nicely with this as well. This capital phi is the aquifer discharge potential, which is closely related to head. In a confined aquifer, it's linearly related to head. In an unconfined aquifer, it's related to head squared. This general equation applies regardless of what kind of aquifer you're dealing with. The elements in the analytic element method are actually functions, which are solutions to this general equation. So it's potential as a function of x, y, and time. And here's about the simplest element you can have, which is the element for a well. And Q is discharge of the well, little r is the radial distance from the well to the point where you're evaluating this function. And there are other elements for line elements and area elements as well. In this general equation, the L sub T is leakage out the top, L sub B is leakage out the bottom, and the storage term is flux into storage. So all of these things on the right-hand side are what I would call distributed sources or sinks, because they don't occur at a point or a line, they occur over areas. The basic elements in analytic element method are point sinks, line sinks, and area sink. So it really just depends on how you're distributing your discharge, which of these kinds of elements you'll need. For wells, we obviously use a point sink, and for line elements, these represent things like river reaches, drains, and so on. We'll use a line sink. And a line sink is really a point sink integrated along a line. And in these two plots, the black dotted lines are equipotential contours, and the blue lines are stream function contours. And in both these cases, they form perfect flow nets, analytic flow nets, roughly square and stream function normal to potential everywhere. This on the right is an area sink inside this green polygon. There's a recharge rate outside of it, a low recharge rate, and that's a distributed source or sink. And in that case, there is no such thing as the stream function, and you can't have a flow net. So our general flow equation is a linear one, which means that we can add solutions up. We can superposition. And this is a concept that you've probably become familiar with in most groundwater textbooks. They talk about the method of images, where you've got a well near a straight or nearly straight constant head boundary, for example. You can put an image well on the opposite side and add those two solutions and achieve the boundary condition you want at that constant head boundary. In this one here, I'm superpositioning six well elements in a special way that creates a constant head boundary on this circle at the outside of the gray area. And it requires certain imaging around the boundary of that circle. And this could be a model of the gray area, which would be three wells and an island surrounded by a constant head shoreline, or it could be the white area, which are three wells surrounding a circular pond with a constant head boundary. The right-hand image shows several line sink elements superpositioned to simulate discharge to a reach of a stream. You can see that's quite a useful application of line elements and a common application. In contrast to the analytic element method, finite difference and finite element methods take the region that you're modeling and break it into numerous small cells or elements. This is a finite difference grid of cells. And then there are nodes associated with these cells or elements. And you write fairly short equations that relate the head at one node to heads at its neighbor nodes. In this case, in a rectangular finite difference grid, the central node is related to heads at six neighbor nodes. And what you end up with, because you've got a lot of nodes and a lot of cells, you end up with a large number of equations, but each equation is fairly short. It doesn't have that many terms in it. Because, for example, with this diagram here, there are six neighbor nodes and the central node, so that's seven terms in the equation. So what's characteristic of these finite difference and finite element methods is large numbers of equations, but each equation fairly short, in contrast to the analytic element method, which tends to do fewer equations, but each is longer. To summarize the pros and cons of the analytic element method compared to numerical methods, I'll go through some of these on a slide. In the positive column for analytic elements is its geometric flexibility. You don't have to define a grid or mesh of elements, and you can place your line elements, your well elements, your area sink elements wherever you want to. You have complete geometric flexibility there. And because you don't have to input a grid or deal with that, there is a lot less input to have to put in when you're building a model. And another thing is that it's very easy to expand or shrink or alter your model with analytic elements. You just add elements where you need them. Whereas with these gridded methods like finite difference, finite element, you have to rebuild the grid, and that can be quite a time-consuming task if, say, you wanted to expand your model. The accuracy of the analytic element approach is quite high. You can, because these are analytic solutions, and they can be evaluated at any x and y and time location, you have great accuracy. For example, if you had a regional model that extended for kilometers horizontally, you could fairly accurately predict the head at the well screen of a fairly small diameter pumping well. And that's something that if you want to do that with the numerical methods, you'd have to build in a whole lot of tiny elements near the well. You don't have to do that with analytic element methods. And that accurate solution is continuous in space and smooth, so that allows for accurate path line tracing and transport if you were to do that. On the negative side, the main negative has to do with these equations. When you're doing a very large, complex model, the analytic element equations are very long, and solving that system of equations can take quite a bit of time. Now, in my experience, if I build an analytic element model that has 10,000 or fewer equations in it, that gives you a lot of latitude to create fairly complex models. If it's below 10,000 equations, it will solve in a matter of a couple of minutes, and really the computational burden is not a real deterrent. But when you get up into the several tens of thousands of equations, then your solve times can start to grow into the, tens of minutes, or some people have done models with 40,000 or 50,000 equations, and they start to approach an hour in solve time. And it becomes a little bit less viable than a similarly complex finite difference or finite element method model. The solve times would be quicker. So the analytic element method in AnAqSim, I think, is a tool that works really well for everything from the simplest of models up to moderate complexity. If you're going to get into extreme complexity, that's the territory where a finite difference or finite element approach would probably be better. The mathematics in finite difference method is quite simple, whereas in finite elements and analytic elements, it's a little more involved, but most people don't have to deal with that, so it's kind of a minor issue. AnAqSim, Analytic Aquifer Simulator, is something that I wrote and first released in 2011, and since then I continuously tweak and update it, adding features, fixing bugs, and whatnot, and about 1 to 4 updates per year since then. And the latest release just came out last month in March, I think. It's written in C sharp. It is a Windows.NET application, and it has a very thorough and integrated graphic user interface. Compared to other analytic element programs that have been out there, including my own earlier 2DAN program, AnAqSim has a lot of important capabilities. These four things listed here: transient, multi-level, anisotropic, and fresh salt interface domains. Very few of the other analytic element programs do any of those or some of those. And that's what kind of sets AnAqSim apart, is that it can do those things. And one of the reasons it can do those things is the way AnAqSim handles domains. In the other analytic element programs, including my own 2DAN, the layers or the domains within AnAqSim were infinite. They extended over the whole two-dimensional plane, and there was flow to and from infinity, which actually confused quite a few people, what was going on there. And every element in the model was internal to this one infinite planar domain. That's not the case in AnAqSim. AnAqSim uses bounded domains, and each domain has its own model, essentially, consisting of elements on its perimeter plus elements that are interior to it. And the way that works out, you can do anisotropy fairly simply in each domain, and each domain can have its own ratio and direction of anisotropy. So it's very general capabilities with respect to that. And because the elements, the models are separate for each domain, the system of equations works out to be somewhat sparse, and that's a little more efficient for solving a more complex model. At the boundaries, the interdomain boundaries where these domains abut each other, the program matches heads and the normal component of discharge. And then when you're stacking domains and making a multi-layer model, the vertical leakage between levels and the storage fluxes are handled by area sinks. And all of this is written up in a 2010 paper that I published in Water Resources Research. Just looking at an example, an AnAqSim model, this one has six domains. In the plan view, this green area actually has four levels in it, so it's a three-dimensional multi-level area inside of the yellow and the blue domains, which are just single-level, two-dimensional simulations. And if we look at the yellow domain here, it has an interdomain boundary here that runs between the yellow and blue, and that's where we match heads and normal discharges. There's another interdomain boundary here that interfaces the one yellow domain on one side and four green domains on the other side. And again, the heads in all five of these domains match at points along that boundary. And the normal component of discharge summed up between these four green domains matches the normal discharge in that one yellow domain. Some other kinds of boundaries you can have at the outside of a domain are normal flux specified, like this purple one here and this blue one up here. Those you specify the normal component of discharge, discharge per length. And if you set that to zero, you get a no flow boundary, but it can be a finite rate. You can also have head specified, this H sub S, that can be external to a domain, or it could be inside of a domain. This shows in the upper left here an AnAqSim model that's just one layer, and it has three different domains. And as a user, you know that you've got these three domains, but they all look like they're part of one model. But under the hood, what AnAqSim is doing is actually creating three separate models, one for each of these domains. And the model for this green one, for example, has boundary line boundary elements around the outside, the external ones, and possibly line boundaries and well elements and area sink elements internal. And down here, we're showing how it handles anisotropy. If it were isotropic, then the models would look something like this under the hood. But let's say that these domains are anisotropic. AnAqSim makes use of a coordinate transformation that's been widely known and used since the 1930s to stretch the coordinates of the domain in the low conductivity direction. So this blue domain, for example, would become, in the equivalent isotropic coordinate system, this blue domain. And the low conductivity direction goes north-south here with these arrows, short arrows, and the high conductivity direction goes east-west, the longer arrows. We basically stretch this domain in the low conductivity direction by the square root of the ratio of these two conductivities. And that can be done differently in each domain, so you can have quite the flexibility with anisotropy. These vertical profiles show some of the flexible layering schemes that are possible with AnAqSim. This shows a single layer area out here where it's kind of coral colored, and that transitions via this interdomain boundary to three layers in here or in here. And in this model, in the uppermost layer, there's an interdomain boundary where we go from the green domain to a blue domain. And the hydraulic properties, conductivity, storage, coefficients, and so on can change from one domain to another. Down here, we have a fairly complex scheme where these three layers, each of them is split into two more in the core area here by interdomain boundaries along the edges here. And this is handy, lets you have multiple layers right in the area of interest. You might have, say, a partially penetrating well right in this core area with a lot of vertical flow components, and you need to do 3D flow there. And as you go further out, the flow is largely horizontal and you don't know a whole lot out there. You don't have much data. So you go to a simpler approach, a single level out here. So it's a quite efficient way to concentrate the computational effort where you need it. The types of domains in AnAqSim are shown here. You can have a confined domain where there's a fixed saturated thickness and transmissivity to the layer. You can have unconfined, where the saturated thickness is a function of head. And you can have hybrid domains like this that transition from confined to unconfined, depending on whether the head is above the base, or excuse me, above the top of the layer, in which case it's confined, or below the top, in which case it's unconfined. You can also have fresh salt interface domains using the Guibin-Herzberg approximation, which basically says that the salt water part out here, which is gray, is static. And you can determine the pressure on the interface based on how deep you are below sea level on that salt water side. And then you equate that same pressure to the head and discharge potential in the freshwater side of the interface. So you can have unconfined fresh salt interface domains like this upper one, or confined domains like this one. A little word of caution, because we're making that assumption of static salt water, these domains shouldn't be used in general for transient simulations where that salt water is moving significantly. Here is an example showing the confined and unconfined type domains. This is a simulation, transient simulation of mine dewatering. There are four layers in the model. The uppermost one is unconfined, and then the next two down, the second and third, are that transitional confined slash unconfined domain. And this red line is the line along which these three profiles have been made. There's recharge coming in the top of the entire model, and this dewatering system is for an open pit mine that gets deeper with time and expands laterally with time. So in the earliest time steps, this green boundary that I'm tracing is the perimeter head specified line sink that would be like a perimeter trench sump that you'd be pumping from. And early in the simulation, this top frame shows the pumping happening in the uppermost level of the model and drawing heads down to about that elevation. And the water table is everywhere in that uppermost layer. Later in the simulation, the pumping shifts deeper into the second layer and gets a little broader laterally. And we're starting to dry out the uppermost layer, dewater it to some degree. And the second layer becomes a bit unconfined near the wells. Later in time, the pumping shifts even deeper into the third layer and broader, and a broad area of the uppermost layer is dewatered, and smaller areas of the second layer are dewatered as well. And AnAqSim has built into it a mechanism for maintaining stability and converging despite layers dewatering. That is actually just out in a paper published in the journal Groundwater. It's in the early view mode of that journal right now, and it will be out in print in the May-June issue. So take a look at that if you're curious. So this simulation, this mind dewatering one, which I think I'd gotten through discussing, was about I think it was about 3,100 equations, and it took 14 seconds to solve all 8 time steps. So for models of this complexity, the time, solve time is not an issue. Here is an example of a fresh salt interface model, and the upper left shows the simulated interface elevation. The sea level is zero, and the interface elevations drop deeper as you go further inland from the shoreline. And then in this broad white area, the interface hits the bottom of the aquifer, and none of the aquifer is got salt water in it in that area. It's a single layer model, and there's recharge over the whole island. I made another version of this model where in this area around this bay right here, which is shown enlarged here, there's a four layer area. That's the interdomain boundary separating a single layer on the outside from four layers on the inside. And there's a well field that's been added right in here, three wells in that area. And this model was able to simulate the effect of these wells being either fully penetrating all the way through the aquifer or partially penetrating only in the uppermost parts of the aquifer, and simulated how much discharge you could expect to get out depending on how you screen those wells. So this diagram down here is a vertical profile going north and south, about like I'm tracing now. From the shoreline through one of these wells. And it shows in green what the interface position would be, the simulated interface, if the well, this well, was fully penetrating, and same with the other wells, all the way through the layer stack here. And that's the most you could discharge out of that well, and the interface comes very close to, but not to the well. If instead you screen the wells in the upper three layers, and didn't screen it in the fourth, you could pump a little harder, and that would draw the interface in a little bit further inland and higher up, and it would give you this blue interface position. If you did just the upper two layers screened in the pumping wells, then you could pump quite a bit more and draw that interface in further and a little bit of upconing right under the pumping wells. And another thing you can do and AnAqSim is to a vertical plane flow model, which is a useful thing for long linear embankment dams or long linear slurry wall cutoff walls and things like that. And to do that, you use a confined domain and you specify a unit saturated thickness. And so you're simulating a unit thick slice in the vertical plane. This model here shows one of those kinds of models for flow under a concrete dam. This boundary here is at the bottom of the reservoir. It's a constant head boundary. This boundary here is underneath the impermeable dam. And this boundary is a constant head boundary under the tailwater of the dam. This is an impermeable boundary at the bottom of the aquifer. And the aquifer is anisotropic. I think it's 4:1 horizontal to vertical. And then there's a lens of lower conductivity material that's 10 times less conductive than its surroundings. And we get these red flow lines and blue head contours. Here's a plan view model with anisotropy and a well and a barrier. Got red path lines here, a kind of a goose egg shaped drawdown cone around this well because it's anisotropic with the higher conductivity direction parallel to the long axis of that ellipse shaped drawdown. And I think the ratio is 3:1 here. Another thing to notice is that path lines don't end up normal to head contours when you've got anisotropy. I mean, they can be, but it's rare. As a rule, they're not normal to each other, except when it's isotropic. Pumping wells in AnAqSim, you can have a discharge specified well in a single domain. You can have a discharge specified well that spans multiple domains vertically, in which case the heads at the well radius are matched in each domain that is screened, and the total discharge from the various domains adds up to the specified discharge. An interesting application of that would be simulating abandoned wells, where you specify zero discharge, but you put a well in that spans multiple domains, and that allows water to move into the well and move vertically and discharge at a deeper level or shallower level. And I know of people in Australia that have used these multi-domain discharge specified wells to simulate abandoned gas wells and the migration of fluids from one aquifer to another. You can also do head specified wells, which are handy for dewatering applications where you know the head you want to achieve and you let AnAqSim compute the discharge required to get that. These are the list of line boundary types in AnAqSim, and it's pretty comprehensive. Just about anything you'd want to do is possible there. The river line boundary is a very commonly used one, and it has an option for whether or not the river itself would dry up if the head and the surrounding aquifer drop below the stage that you specify, or whether it would continue to be perched and contribute flow to the aquifer. All of these, depending on what you're specifying, say it's a head specified well, you digitize a polyline and you specify the head or whatever is specified at the endpoints of the polyline, and AnAqSim will interpolate values at intermediate points in the polyline. You can have drains or fractures that have resistance to flow along them. You specify a conductance. You can have leaky barriers, sheet pile walls that do leak at some level, and you specify the conductance for that. At the top and bottom of your model, you can specify basically two kinds of conditions. First would be specified flux, where you have a discharge per area that you're specifying, and that would be recharged typically at the top of a model. Or at the bottom of a model, you might have leakage to a deeper layer that you specify, or maybe you call that impermeable and specify zero flux there. You can also have a head-dependent flux, and this is used often for leakage to a surface water that overlies a domain. And you specify the head in the surface water, and AnAqSim computes the vertical leakage based on the head difference and the vertical conductivity of your domain. You can use that also for the deepest layer in your model to simulate a head-dependent flux to an even deeper layer that you're not simulating, but you do know the heads in it. And these can be specified at constant values within a domain or within a polygon that you draw. And they can also be a surface that you create from a list of X, Y, and value data. So if you wanted a spatially variable recharge rate in your aquifer, you could do that with this feature here. AnAqSim, unlike most AEM programs, has complete transient capabilities, meaning that you can basically make almost anything, any input in the model, transient. And the general equation, going back to one of our early slides, is this, written in terms of this discharge potential. The right side is a bunch of distributed source or sink terms, leakage out the top, leakage out the bottom, and flux into storage. That storage term, derivative, is approximated using finite differences. So this bottom equation is really what AnAqSim is solving. And the delta H is the head change at a point over the course of a time step of length delta t. And it uses backward finite differences pretty much the same way is done in modflow. And the input for it is also very similar to modflow. You specify periods, and inside of periods, the stresses and boundary conditions are constant, but you can put in multiple periods and change, you know, recharge rates, heads at wells, and so on. For each period, there are steps, and there's a step multiplier that causes the steps to grow by this factor through the simulation, letting you concentrate time steps, shorter ones, near the beginning of a period, right after stresses have changed. Here are things that can be transient in an AnAqSim. You have discharge specified heads, wells and line boundaries. You can have head specified wells and boundaries where the head changes. You can have rivers where the stage changes. These top conditions we just talked about, the flux or the head at a head dependent flux, can change with time. The head specified well and line boundaries can also be turned off in specific periods, which is handy for things like that dewatering simulation that I showed you, where the pumping got deeper and more extensive laterally with time in the simulation. So I turned some on and others off as that progressed. This is a brief comparison of some of the more popular analytic element programs over the last decade or two. And AnAqSim on the left here has very comprehensive capabilities compared to the others. And I would say these top four are really important capabilities: being able to do multi-level 3D simulations, transient simulations, anisotropy, and the flexible layering. And none of the others have all of those. In fact, the only one that comes somewhat close is TTIM, which is written by Mark Bakker. And that's a good program, but it's limited to only confined domains, and it's limited in terms of the types of elements that are available to it. Quite a shorter list of elements, and it doesn't have a graphic user interface. If you go to the AnAqSim website, there's a page that has checks of the program, and I think it's about 20 different ones. I'll just show you a few for examples here. This is a check of AnAqSim compared to the TICE solution, an analytic solution for transient flow to the well. And there are two sets of curves here at different radii, and you can see that the AnAqSim curves fall pretty much on top of the analytic solution curves. This is an analytic solution by Hantush for a rectangular recharge area, transient flow. And this is the AnAqSim simulated head versus time at one corner of the rectangle. And the red dots are hand calculations using that Hantush solution. Again, pretty much identical. Did a simulation comparing AnAqSim to mod flow, and in this simulation there were multiple layers. There was anisotropy, transience, heterogeneity, and so on. And the AnAqSim contours of head at a particular time step are shown on the left two panels and two layers, and the equivalent mod flow model contours are shown on the right, and they are not exactly identical, but they're very close. And actually, some of the difference comes down to the approximations made in the mod flow model. Okay, I'm going to switch modes here and open up an AnAqSim model and walk you through some of it to demonstrate. This model is fairly straightforward and simple. It has truly only about four lines of input. It's homogeneous. There's only one domain. It's one level. It's two-dimensional. And it's steady state, isotropic, unconfined aquifer with a uniform recharge and a cross flow going. And it has a well. Let's just hit solve, which solves the system of equations for unknowns, and then make plot to plot head contours and path lines, which looks like this. And the blue are the head contours, the red are the path lines. And let's just walk through this model. If I right click, there's a context menu that pops up, and I can edit the domain properties for the domain that I'm in. This brings up a table. A lot of, or almost all of, AnAqSim's input is in these tables like this. This is an unconfined domain. It has a bottom elevation of 0, this porosity, and a conductivity of 8. Go back to the plot. This outermost circle is a series of head-specified line boundaries, and if I right-click, I can edit the nearest line boundary. And this is just one line of input to create that circle that has a radius of 1,000, a gradient that imposes a head gradient of 0.006 near the middle of that circle, and the gradient direction is 30 degrees counterclockwise from the x-axis, and hence the flow that we see. The far field flow is going in that direction. We could edit the nearest well. There's one well at the center of this model, has a radius of 0.25, discharge extraction of minus 240. And then the recharge coming in is done with an area sink. You can edit that. And it's got a top flux of 0.0005 and an impermeable bottom to the model. So that's pretty much the entire input for this model. If we zoom in a little bit here, just doing this with the scroll wheel on my mouse, and I move the cursor around, you can see values to the left changing. You can, the coordinates, you can get the head, the saturated thickness, average linear velocity, and so on. And there are quite a few other things, leakage out the top, leakage out the bottom, and so on, that would come into play a little bit more in a multi-level model. If we hover over these path lines, information pops up and tells you the travel time. These path lines are well path lines that start just outside the well screen and are sent upstream. So this is 365 days upstream of the well, one year, and here we're 2 years out, and so on. And these path lines work their way upstream, going backwards against the flow, and they all terminate at these circles where they basically bump into the water table. And that takes about 8 years or so, a little more than 8 years, to get out to here. Okay, we could create a profile of this. If I right click, one of the things I can do is digitize line, and I'll draw a line from here through the well out to there. And then we'll, excuse me, go to the analysis menu and create a vertical profile. I'll paste in those coordinates that we just created, and let's show the head, the domain boundaries, and the path lines. And here is that profile. And the well path line started 20% of the way down. Here's the well going. It's a fully penetrating because it's a single layer model. These path lines started 20% of the way down and went upstream and eventually out here, like we saw. If we go back to our model, you can see that the continuity of the well are somewhat coarse. We can make a more detailed plot in this window if we right click and set the plot window to this view and then make a new plot. We'll have much more resolution. When you zoom in a plot, you get greater resolution. There are other controls that can enhance your resolution as well. Let's say we wanted to input a barrier boundary. I'll right click, digitize a polyline, and just start clicking randomly and create that boundary there. Go to the model input, put in a leaky barrier boundary, and just give it some letters for a name. That's just a label. And the conductance I'm going to say is 0.005, and the same at the other end. So it's that conductance all along its length. And then I'm going to paste in the coordinates we just digitized. And we'll need to solve the model again because we've added new features. And if we look at the equations, it now has 36 equations instead of 24 without barrier. There are some unknowns associated with that barrier that had to be solved for. And now if we make a plot, we can see our barrier having its effect there. And we could zoom into this closer up view, make that the current view. And I want to show you how you can edit line boundaries. You can click on it, and now you'll see these little squares at each vertex. You can drag those X's and change the shape, make it a little more squiggly. And if you want, you can add a vertex. Put another one in there. Make it go like that. And it's possible also to drag and move the well around. I won't bother doing that right now. But since we changed some of the input, we got to solve, make a plot. And there we are now with our barrier moved around quite a bit. And it's quite easy. You can we could make the barrier 10 times more conductive at the start than at the end, and it'll interpolate those conductances in between. Solve that, make a plot. We can see it leaking quite a bit at this end compared to not so much at that end. Okay, I think that pretty well covers that demonstration. Okay, this is an actual consulting project I worked on last year in the Bay Area of California. It's a thick aquifer, about 1,000 feet thick. And they had a municipal pumping well, and they had done a pumping test of that well and recorded both the heads in that pumping well and the heads in some nearby observation wells. This test happened a long time ago and was done somewhat crudely, but they had this data. They also measured with a borehole flow meter, where the flow coming into the screen of this pumping well was coming in. And a lot of it came in this uppermost orange layer that has the highest conductivity. So calibrated the hydraulic conductivities and storage parameters to the observations here and ended up with this model. And this model, it was transient, and I think it was about 1,300 equations and multiple time steps, and it took about 12 seconds to solve. The time periods that were used, our time unit was minutes in this case, so 12 hours of pumping, 8 time steps, and a multiplier of 1.5. Here is simulated drawdown versus radial distance from the municipal well at the end of the simulation, 12 hours into pumping. There was about 40 feet of drawdown at the pumping well, which was screened in levels 5, 6, and 7. So those curves there. And layers that were below that and above that experienced quite a bit less in drawdown because this system is quite stratified and the vertical conductivities are quite a bit less than the horizontal conductivities. This shows drawdown versus radial distance in level 1, how it evolved through time here, very small amount of drawdown, fraction of a foot, and in level 5, which is the uppermost level that was screened, and that again had about 40 feet of drawdown, but you can see further out from the well that tended to evolve with time. Here's the drawdown at the pumping well, 40 feet or so, and it drew down quite rapidly at that very small radius, as you'd expect, and then was nearly steady later in the pumping test. Here are the AnAqSim simulated curves of drawdown at the three observation wells. These are the shades of blue shown here, this curve, that one, and that one. And then these other curves are three different dates when they did similar 12-hour pumping cycle and recorded heads at the observation wells. And it was intended to fit that as well as possible. And this is the discharge distribution along that well screen. Remember, it was screened across three different domains. And this lowest curve, which shows the greatest amount of discharge, is that skinny but very permeable layer near the top of the screen. And this is the intermediate one and the deepest layer, which is lower conductivity still. Early in the test, you can see the impact of storage causing the discharge distribution to vary a bit, but then it becomes quite steady later in the test when the storage near the well has less impact. Here's a multi-layer model with a remediation scheme, and the whole model is shown here. Kind of looks like a happy Mr. Potato Head, but it's a single layer in this area, and then this highlighted boundary with the vertexes highlighted is an interdomain boundary where it's four layers inside of that. Here's a close-up of that four-layer area. There's a permeable passive remediation trench. Well, not so passive because there's a well at the downstream end of it. And the next slide will show a section along this yellow line here. Well, not the next slide, the one after this. Here's the whole regional model. It's got recharge, which kind of causes the heads to mount far from the boundaries, some rivers, and constant head out here, and so on. Here's the close-up of the remediation system area. We've started path lines at the water table inside this red polygon at a large number of points that are regularly spaced and sent them downstream. And most of them get into this permeable trench, ride in it, and then get swallowed by the well at this end of it. Some of them bypass it altogether. Some of them get into the trench. They get pulled upwards and get into the trench, which is only in the uppermost layer. And then some of them dive back out of the trench before being captured by the well. This is the same thing, but showing only those path lines that were captured by the well. You can constrain the display of path lines that way to show what's being captured by a well or by a river reach, and that's quite handy. Okay, that is pretty much all I have to show, and I see we've got about 5 minutes left, and I'm very happy to take questions. And I think the way to do it is to just type any question you might have into the chat box there, and I will try to answer it for you. Let's see. One question from Ryan says, does AnAqSim have an automatic calibration function? The answer, quick answer is no, it doesn't have it built in, but several users have used it. It has a mode where you can run it from the command line, and people have used it with PEST for parameter estimation. PEST will, you can instruct it to seek certain input variables and output variables and then adjust those with subsequent simulations. And people have been able to do that with PEST. So it's not built in, but it is possible. Linton says that Paul Shea once stated that the AEM was not very useful. Now that you have transient capability, he is very mistaken. Well, I guess I agree with you. But he was, well, he wasn't right that it wasn't very useful. It was just useful for a fairly limited set of things back in the early days. It had to be two-dimensional and steady, pretty much. But there are two-dimensional and steady problems that people want to solve, and it was a good tool for that. But yeah, adding full transient capability was a, in my mind, a very big step. And it turns out in my consulting, I used to use Modflow quite a bit to do transient things. And I actually haven't used Modflow in a couple of years because I find that I can do pretty much what I want to do with AnAqSim. But anyway, I'll put this page up while the typing happens there. And these are some more resources, all of which you can get at from the fitzgeosolutions.com website, which turns out to be the same exact place as anaxim.com. They both direct to the same website. There's a six-session webinar series called AnAqSim in Depth that's starting in 2 weeks, one session per week, similar one-hour session with a Q&A at the end. These, in addition, will have optional exercises that you can work on in between the sessions, and I'll distribute a key to those exercises kind of late in the week in between sessions. There are training videos and tutorials, the user guide, lots of checks, some references, and so on the website, and I hope you visit that. And here's another question from Tom. Is storage in the pumped well accounted for? No, if you're referring to storage in the wellbore, no, it's just storage out in the aquifer that's accounted for. Thank you all for attending, and I ask you if you wouldn't mind staying on just for a second. There's a little thing that pops up with how would you rate this webinar and a little text box for inputting your comments, and I'd appreciate that feedback if you would not mind taking the time to do that. But thank you all for attending, and feel free to contact me if you have questions about anything. And hope to see some of you at the six session webinar series in a couple of weeks. Thanks. I'll sign off.